St. Peter Port, the Channel Islands. 10 strong men and true arrive to see who can catch the most fish. TVS, who sponsor the competition, prepare to document the sport at sea.
See you later.
The skippers speak encouraging words about the weather forecast.
Bloody awful.
All aboard.
Wednesday looks good, but tomorrow it'll be bloody awful.
The final is underway.
Right, lads, up line, please. Up line.
Must have known we were coming, thought the anglers. Why else the military band, the crowds in the streets, and very thoughtfully a parade of the biggest powerboats and the prettiest girls you have ever seen. And when all that got a bit tedious, even the Red Arrows, by way of a diversion. Just conceivably, the RAF may have been too preoccupied to realise that they were performing for the Red Arrows of Anglia. Ten sea fishermen who'd beaten tens of thousands of fellow anglers into the finals of the highly regarded TVS competition. Drawn on boat A for the first day, David Henry, a quantity surveyor from New Haven. Zenith Waghorn, a Royal Mail manager from the Seabrook Club in Kent. And dressed in the uniform of the Antarctic Angling Club, but representing Hythe and District in Hampshire, a plumber called Jeff Bullen. Steve Mills from Gosport, an England international, getting the measure of lively little Guernsey fish. And Roy Hewkins, a Kent miner from Deal, hooking the boat, intending to work down in size to hooking fish. Drawn for the first day on boat B, a gin palace lookalike called the Belle de Cirque, a former winner Paul Cartwright from Herne Bay in Kent. Steve Skeets, a wizard with computers and finding the best seat in the boat, representing the Langston Club in Hampshire. And Rob Cartwright, who claims to be the most seasick fisherman on the Isle of Wight. Fishing the bow together, Ron Yates from Eastbourne, who went to the Tunisia finals in 84, and from the Azores final of 86, Chris Cox, representing the Worthing Club, and a very stern line in fishing philosophy.
There's always tomorrow.
There's always yesterday as well, according to the boatman. Should have been here yesterday.
The skippers were right, of course. We should have been there yesterday. Today, it was too rough on the high tide to start anywhere but in St. Peter Port Bay itself. The sound of fish flapping onto the deck, conspicuous by its absence. Championship fishermen and no championship fish. But some consolation, what every angler loves to see at the rod tip, a powerboat enthusiast, one of many drivers practicing for the 88th World Offshore title in Guernsey, who chose to practice where the anglers were angling.
This is the first time ever. I think it's going to get a bit noisy very soon.
Do you think it'll put the fish off?
I hope not. Hasn't had a lot of effect on my fish yet, anyway.
I don't think you've had a nibble yet, have you?
I haven't had a touch.
You could hook into one of those. They've qualified. They're over a foot.
And they're over a foot long, that's true, yes, yeah. I think they've put out a bit of a struggle, though.
Look at that.
Bring it in, set with a big net.
Look at that.
Let me lift it.
Yeah.
Well, one of these. Always wanted a pain.
Somewhere in here. And 12 inch. It's a Dyson, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's about
oh,
there.
Yes. Yes. First wire.
Right. Well, I've got a fish.
Everybody up?
Yeah. We've got to change the tackle again.
Upline, please. Upline.
end of the strong wind warning. This is Jersey Radio. Jersey Radio listening, 2182 kilohertz. Channel 16, channel 82, VHF. Jersey Radio, out.
And now more music.
There you are, that's where skill comes in, doesn't it?
Now that's a proper fish. Beautiful fish.
Beautiful fish.
Yeah.
Cracker. Very pleased.
Oh, it's a rat.
Called on ragworm. It's about £3, I suppose.
In colour and body shape, it's reminiscent of a carp, isn't it?
It's very similar, yeah. Very similar.
And what do you call that, then?
That's my first fish of the day.
I suppose it's better than nothing, but only just, what is it, a little pouting?
It's a little tiny pouting, a little baby.
I don't really come much smaller than that. Will you be requiring the net or the ruler for that?
Not at this stage, no. Perhaps later.
I should leave it
when
on
it grows
it
up.
Make quite a good bait, actually.
Quite, yes. No, he's going to go back while he's still alive.
Ready, Gust?
At this point, it's worth introducing the other principal players in the unfolding drama. First, the king ragworm, a ghastly creature with jaws at one end and legs down each side, for some reason regarded as a delicacy by fish. To be sure of supplies, some anglers brought a box full with them on the aeroplane from home. The native bait, live sand eels lying like shiny knives in their tank, awaiting a turn on the hook. A task not widely enjoyed by sand eels on the whole, but one in which very few have a choice.
Sand eel is by far the best bait. And it's just a shame that in here it's working, but it's working on the fish that are really too small for the competition. But you mentioned the salmon flies down.
Yes.
Down there.
Yes.
Well, more for sentimental reasons than anything, but in 71 my very good friend Ron, who died 2 weeks ago, Ron Edwards, won it with salmon feathers in the Shetlands. And I won it the year after using the same salmon feathers. Now, they aren't the same salmon feathers, but the same man tied them again for us. And I had to bring them because it's a similar type of fishing. And just occasionally, if there's a lot of cold fish, pollock, they will really take them very, very quickly.
There is a misunderstanding that the Channel Islands are somehow blessed with meteorological magic. Guernseymen will admit, though, that it's nonsense. It's just as cold and wet as anywhere. And as if to prove the point, they laid on a spectacular demonstration. And the miserable burst of weather coincided, of course, with a shoal browsing past the forest fissure. It brought a cuckoo wrasse for Roy Hewkins. Fish began to arrive everywhere. A fine pollock falling to David Henry. And guess what? In the stern, even Zen broke into single figures.
The first one of the day. I've got a weigh in at last. I was getting a bit worried, I must have been. But I'm there.
The boats were obliged by competition rules to hunt for fish within a mile of each other. And further inshore to Guernsey, Belle de Cirque missed the worst of the weather and continued to catch the best of the fish. But these were not big fish. They were young fish, small fish, pollock and pouting, and more wrasse.
They tell us there's a lot of rye and skate here, and it seems sacrilege to let them stay. Yeah.
They don't want you to have them.
No, they don't fish for them. That's the thing we can't understand.
Why not?
I don't know. Whether they don't like the effort put into hauling the anchor or what. Everything they do, they drift.
Well, I heard what Ron said, and I think I would tend to agree with him. Although I quite like doing what we're doing now. You know, this suits me down to the ground for competition purposes.
And you're doing quite well at it, aren't you, so far? I think you're into fish number 11.
This should be me, 11.
There it is.
he's got the magic touch.
Smaller. I wouldn't want to keep him if I was just ordinary fishing, mind you.
But in competition, he kept everything, and Chris Cox came home with 17 pounds of fish, top weight for the first day.
OK, lads, line's up. That's it for today. Thank you very much. It'll be finer tomorrow.
What, you might ask, has all this got to do with catching fish? The answer? Absolutely nothing. Though it is all part of an angler's education, so here's the serious bit. Guernsey, like all the Channel Islands, remembers all too clearly the dark days of the occupation. 13,000 German troops and slave workers were sent to little Guernsey alone. They outnumbered the population. And why? Well, really, because for Hitler, it was the nearest thing to a piece of England that he could actually get his hands on. Here in the Occupation Museum near St. Peterport, they've recreated a street much as it would have been in those dark 5 years, when there was a 9 o'clock curfew, when food was desperately scarce, when parents worried about their children, evacuated and unheard of in the mainland, and lived in fear of imprisonment for doing the slightest thing against the fatherland. The Germans kept tight control of everything, issuing permits for this, warrants for that. You even needed a license to collect seaweed. But food being at a premium, they insisted that the Guernsey people went fishing. The Germans took a fifth of the catch and issued an armed guard to make sure that nobody absconded. That was fishing for survival. But these 2 days, 10 anglers from the south of England are here fishing for fun. And of course, the honour of becoming TVS Sea Angling Champion for 1988.
You know the man who's in the best position? And that's maybe Henry. Got £10, right? He's on the best boat today.
Yeah, I think he must be your favourite.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, win his boat today and it could be all over, couldn't it?
Absolutely. Our job is to get him to turn his engine off.
There was an added urgency about day two. They'd sized up the area, sized up the skippers, and thought they'd sized up the target and fancied the best fishing off the Isle of Sark. And beneath it, an element of needle was creeping in. Someone, in their enthusiasm, had been badgering the skippers to go where they did not want to go.
And one of your blokes has told me now, and I'm pretty bloody annoyed. Well, we are the blokes that know. We're around here. I've been around Sark 2 or 3 times, and there's no bloody fish.
Well, I'd like to try Sark myself, for the reason that then they'll know what we're up against. I mean, you know, if they want to go to Sark, we'll go to Sark.
So it was that the skippers Arnie Brayo and Roy Taylor set course for the waters where another local boat had struck lucky the day before, off Sark. Sark, as everyone knows, is the island where there are no cars and not many houses, but it's an island with its own government and its own identity. To spare your discomfort, we're here by helicopter. Down there, on the competition boats, they're discovering why the skippers were reluctant to come. The 9-mile wallow to Sark could be seen as a rotten, uncomfortable waste of time should there be no fish. And the skippers couldn't promise fish, of course, until they started to emerge.
Oh, he's only just hooked. Look at that.
Good. Well, that's done you a bit of good in the competition.
There you are, Paul. You think I tell fibs, don't you?
Alongside, in the comparative shelter of a Sark Bay, Steve Mills began to get results too. Another pollock arriving, connected by monofilament to Ron Yates, cheering him up no end.
Is that your first of the day?
Second, yeah.
Oh, you had the mackerel, didn't you?
No, I've had another pollock as well. Yeah, I sneaked that one up before you was watching, actually.
Oh, I didn't see that. Oh, Chris hasn't got anything, has he?
Don't rub it in. I've never
bite
yet.
I'm surprised you're only using one hook. At this stage in the competition, I would have thought three hooks would have... desperation would have set in, really.
Well, no, it's anybody's competition. No, on this sort of fishing with sand eel, there is no doubt when there are few fish that a single hook will work better than three, than multi.
Yeah. Oh, oh, oh. Oh.
That, stealing the scene in the stern, is Rob Cartwright. And while you watch him at work, consider that when he started the sport a couple of years ago, he was often so seasick he had to fish lying down in the bottom of the boat. It being the day after his birthday, Rob has taken celebration drink and seasick pills in equal quantities and is feeling as fit as a fish.
How are things going on your boat, mate?
It's not very swift on here, I'm afraid, but a couple of the lads have got the crack down, slowly dropping the eel down and then slowly retrieving it. He's picking up more fish and they're coming at a better rate all the time.
And what about Zenith?
Zenith is a grave disappointment, I'm afraid. He's had one fish which has stopped his suicidal tendencies for a little while, but he needs to buck up. I've had severe words with him about it.
You may wonder how skippers know there are fish about. Experience, yes, a nose for the sea, a feel for the water, certainly, and perhaps native cunning.
Right, lads, down lines. It looks more promising here. We're on gravel, and there's a bit of signs of fish on the sounder, so it looks promising, yeah.
But okay. How did Arnie Breo know all that?
That's what they call a video sounder. Yes, indeed, it detects fish. At the moment, we haven't anything on the screen. We're passing over an area where there's no fish, but immediately there'll be fish there, shoals of fish, or even the feed, the bait, that'll all come up. It'll all come up on there, yes.
Isn't that a bit unsporting because I haven't got one on the other boat?
No, not really. Not really.
I've got mine down.
Yeah, go for it.
Just to distract you from the fishing for a moment, at this stage on the horizon came a sight no cameraman could resist. The world's fastest powerboats at it for the world title. So while the others fish on, we'll take the helicopter and have a look.
Hound fishing, bubble dazzle, dazzle, dazzle. Got your hound dog by your side.
That's old Cindy Lou's dog.
Gone fishing.
We gone fishing instead of just a wishing. Oh yeah.
Ah, very nice. But away from the speed and the power, the other breed of sportsmen have been fighting on.
Last of the big spenders, eh?
At last, in a quiet cove, where the boat stayed level just long enough to think.
How's your day been, Jeff?
Oh, not too bad. It's picked up in the last hour or so, you know. I've only had one pollock for quite some time, but I've caught two more since.
Oh, better than yesterday.
Couldn't have been much worse than yesterday, it has to be. No. So what's better than yesterday, in fact?
Well, I had a fish in the first 10 minutes today, so that set me off happy. And I've got four now, so it's just knowing how to look after the sand eel when it's down on the bottom fishing, you know, mm-hmm. And present it to the fish. I'm just beginning to get the hang of it now.
Nearly time to go home, though.
Exactly, yes. It may be a little too late. But, no, it's been a better day today.
Yeah. What about the anti-blood sport people? Have they been after you as sea fishermen, like they have the course boys?
Not sea fishing yet.
No.
No, they'll have a go, probably, in due course.
What do you say to them?
Well, we try to be humane with fish.
Yes.
I think...
seen evidence, even here, where one can be. We're catching fish and you're killing fish. You can't hide that, you can't odds it. But if we've caught undersized fish,
you
want to get it straight back into the water, because if it's undersized, it's not going to be kept.
And it's handled as gently as you can.
Here, you may start to notice a subtle change. You may possibly notice that Paul Cartwright is retrieving rather faster now. It's because time is running out and he needs more fish. Paul and his neighbour, Ron Yates, are neck and neck for top weight in the competition. The overnight leader, Chris Cox, has had a dreadful day. This needs to be a big one, and it is. Unfortunately, it's seaweed and doesn't count. Steve Mills changes bait, tries a sophisticated new technique.
Desperation. You're getting very near the end, and one big fish will sort it all out.
What might be lurking around here in this little bay, then?
A conger.
Now, that really would settle it, wouldn't it?
Yes.
That'll do.
You came, you saw, you conger.
Can we pretend we didn't hear that?
OK.
There's a man at the front chasing conger. Is he,
Yeah, I was thinking about doing that myself with a strip of mackerel, but I don't think there's much likelihood of them getting one. No, I don't think there is. Still, you never know, do you?
And what about you, Zen? You're putting on a size 16 gilt hook with a maggot.
I'm trying anything.
Regular,
that's right. Yeah. So, it's all or nothing. Maybe the odd carp about. Mind, I've done better today. Hey, so do you mind not using my ping rags freely? Oh, is it yours? Yeah, they are. Are they really? They are. Oh, it's there, isn't it?
Waghorn and Bullen may not have caught many fish, but at least they made them laugh. Their neighbour, Roy Hewkins, was also doing so badly. Even that famous lager couldn't help. Then, suddenly, on Forest Fisher, the last 4 minutes became mayhem. A shoal of suicidal wrasse appeared, virtually queuing up to come aboard. If Paul Cartwright was doing well, Ron Yates, next to him, was doing even better. And after 16 hours of slow angling, unbelievably, it became a sprint to the finish.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3. Lines up, gentlemen. That concludes the 1988 TVS Sea Angling Finals.
Thank you very much, TVS. Thank you very much.
Rolling and pitching home towards the weigh-in, that last flurry of fish was much discussed. Could it possibly have won for Ron Yates? Could it have tipped the scales for Paul Cartwright? Would Zenith Waghorn have to go behind the clubhouse with his service revolver? 16 fish counted safely into the basket to the credit of Ron Yates. Too heavy for the weighing machine, in fact.
To weigh it twice?
Yeah, just.
The second day brought his total to 34 pounds, 10 ounces. Paul Cartwright, after two steady angling days, close behind and anxiously watching the scales. Then came the sums.
And the winner of the 1988 TVS Sea Angling Championship in Guernsey by 1 pound, 3 ounces is Ron Yates.
It was the closest finish they'd had since the competition began. Barely a pound of fish separating first and second after 16 hours at sea. Ron described it as the height of his fishing career.
The prestige of winning the TVS trophy is, I think, one of the greatest achievements at any club. I mean, regardless who the representative is, you know, it's something that the club wants to win.
It's still a premier sea angling event for me. And I'm just delighted to be here and delighted to have been running up and delighted to see somebody new win.
Bring it in, sent with a big net.
Look at that.
Well, yes, you are. Yes. First wire.
Haven't had a bite yet.
Here's Cracker.
Ah, now you're talking.
Trying anything.
Oh, he's only just hooked. Look at that.